It's on.
Hey folks, we're going to start off with a public hearing, which is not actually the board meeting. It's Ms. Shelley's hearing that she's going to do for us, Conservation Academy. So we're going to get that started.
Good evening. How are y'all?
Be here.
I'm glad y'all are here. This is a public hearing for the District of Innovation process. This is the second step and moving towards District of Innovation status. The board passed a resolution to start the process, beginning the process, so if that makes any sense. And basically this hearing is to explain and to discuss the possibilities of a District of Innovation plan or becoming a District of Innovation and what it is. So I'll make it just as short as I can and be simple. Basically, what is a District of Innovation and why do we choose to pursue that? In the it was passed into law by the 84th legislative session in House Bill 1842, and which created Texas Education Code Chapter 12A. It's a bill that was passed into law during the 2015 session, allowing school districts to take advantage of flexibilities that charter schools have available. It's a good thing. It's a positive thing. It's nothing that is mysterious or ensues mystery into your district. It's a positive, good thing. And it boils down to it's a locally controlled process, a locally driven process that gives us more local control. Innovation plans will be about local control, with certain exemptions of the statutes that the state education code has. How can you be eligible for a district of innovation plan, or become a district of innovation district title? As a district's most recent accountability rating must be at least acceptable. So if we were a non-acceptable district, we could not be eligible to even consider doing that. District of Innovation plan is good for 5 years and may be amended, rescinded, or renewed at any time. Please note that it is a very transparent process. The Board of Trustees approves everything that goes on with the District of Innovation plan. Any exemptions that are considered, the Board of Trustees have to approve that. The plan has to be approved by the Board of Trustees. Any changes, any amendments, renewing, rescinding, anything, everything must go through the Board of Trustees for approval. Okay? Why would a school district choose to pursue this option? Okay, there's many different reasons. Every school district will have different reasons. It's a personalization process, what your district needs. It is depends on as far as what the district needs and the student needs, what's in the best interest of our students. Not any two plans are going to look the same from a district, okay? So they're going to pursue it for different reasons. What kind of flexibilities do we have? Some of the considerations that we could look at for some of the exemptions that we are allowed to look at could be or are not limited to some things that I may point out is uniform start date, which is school start date and end date, first day of school, last day of school, which would give us more equitable balanced days of instruction in each semester. Okay, so that would be good because usually our first semester tends to be this way and our second semester tends to be that way. So, and that kind of is going against what we want more instruction before state assessments. than after. Anything that's considered for no consideration that we are not allowed to look at as far as exemptions goes that are in statutes, that are in the code, but not limited to, is district governance, curriculum, state assessment, state accountability system, school finance, federal requirements. Let me just make a little comment about that. Any, you know, all of the districts must be mindful, and I'm encouraged to think about how the flexibility choices, those flexibility choices that we look at wanting to consider are like the school calendar, instructional minutes of the day, attendance, because compulsory attendance still ties in, you know, stays in place. Anything that is tied to funding as far as the federal government, you know, as far as the requirements that they tell us that we have to do to receive funding, such as Title I, we are still bound to that, to those requirements. So we're not exempt from that. So if a district wanted to look at instructional minutes, okay, as far as what we are required to do, we still have to look at meeting those minutes because we are a Title I school district and we want to receive that funding. We need that funding. So that's one of the things that y'all need to be mindful as a district of. Every exemption requested, like I said, must be in the plan, must be approved by the board, and those are some of the things that we need to look at. Process for the innovation status, like I said, this is the second step in the process of moving forward to trying to see if we want to do that, and that will be up to our board. They will approve whether to decline to move forward or approve us to go ahead and pursue it. We have already passed the resolution, the board did, on February 13th, and the school board, now we are holding a public hearing here on the 23rd. What else is in our timeline of what needs to be done, the school board will decline or pursue the designation for District of Innovation in a vote. And then the school board will appoint, if it is pursued, the school board will appoint committees as our district advisory committee, our DEIC is what we call it, which is our district advisory committee, to develop the plan if they pursue. Our district education improvement committee is a cross-section of different people on each campus and some community members. Committee develops and posts the website. Once that committee develops a plan, they will post that plan on the website for 30 days. Okay, that is a must. For 30 days, and then after that 30 days, we will notify TEA, and that is a requirement as well, to that we are voting on a plan. Okay, our committee votes on the plan, and then after if the committee approves and votes and approves the plan, then it is taken to the board and the board votes on the plan, okay, whether or not they want to approve it or not. So with all of this and with the committee working on a plan and developing a plan, please keep in mind that the committee will work together with TASB legal consultants and counsel to make sure that we are aligned with all local policies, and the local policies will be aligned with the exemptions that we are pursuing, okay? So everything will be within legal boundaries, okay? Plan requirements. And there are two questions that they really pointed out that we have to ask ourselves when the committee meets to develop the plan is, how does the current requirement inhibit the district? What is the problem? How does that statute inhibit us? What does it do to create a barrier for Sabine ISD that we can make it better, okay, if we didn't have that in place? And how would the district change the requirement? Okay, those are some two questions that we would ask. Basically, that is it as far as an overview, and you know, it gets much more detailed because there's many, many exemptions to consider, and that's where the committee would come in and decide what we need to look at and how we would benefit from some of those exemptions. I know some of the popular ones are school calendar dates as far as start date and end date, teacher certifications. For CTE, we would look at it as for CTE hard to fill areas if we had to look at that. let's see, teacher ratio and student ratio, class size, but that's something that we don't want to do. We want to make sure that our classes are below, right at what our limits should be. So there's a lot of things to consider. So, but the committee would look at that and make sure that we are looking at everything and seeing how we could be benefit from the written exemptions. Okay. Any questions?
This is your only chance to talk.
It's pretty broad, but then it, you know, but there's pretty tight requirements. TEA does not approve the plan. They just put in rules for things that we put in the plan.
I just was curious to know if you guys had seen, like, 40 ISD, I think, had like a video that was really explanatory. You know, it's really good at illustrating, you know, the purpose of the DOI and everything. So I didn't know if there's a way, if we put together something like that, or, you know what I mean, just so that
teachers can have a better,
you know what I mean, but it was really informative. It made it, you know, really understandable.
Yeah, I think that would be something that would be great for the website, to the parents or anybody could go to and access. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that would be good. And it would be simple. We can put something together. Any other questions?
I have one. And I'm assuming there is a mechanism. Again, we don't even know what we're going to apply for yet until the committee meets, looks at all our actions. But once we approve a plan, can, or what is the mechanism for, oh, we never thought of this, we want to add that to our plan. Is there a mechanism to...
Amendments?
Yes.
We would take them straight to you, to the board to approve.
And does that have to then be approved by the state also at that point?
No, we would just notify them of any amendments or any changes. That's all we were required to do, is notify.
The greatest benefit of this is local control. That's the reason, it's the why, it's the who cares. It's we have more local control with this than we do without this.
That is the first thing that's usually in all of our literature that I've looked at, is it is a locally driven process. It provides flexibility and more local control.
The amendments, Dr. Morchak, can be done at any time after the board passes on, but the amendments can be done any time. There's not a cycle that you have to wait for or anything like that.
Does the board have to approve amendments?
Yeah,
yes.
We definitely want
Yeah, to everything that. Goes through the board. I mean, everything.
Okay. What? How long do you anticipate that the committee will look at this before, you know, a plan is actually made?
I would say, as soon as we get approval from the board, we'll, you know, I will call the committee together, and we will start working on that as soon as we can get that done.
Okay.
It's a process.
Okay.
But we cannot go to a district of innovation status until we have gone through the complete process.
Okay. What teachers are on the DEIC committee presently? Do you know?
Off the top of my head, I don't have that information in front of me, but we have like 2 to 3 teachers per campus.
Per campus, mm-hmm. Yeah. Because the biggest...
And from each department.
Yeah, you know, I just came back from a conference in Corpus Christi, and mm-hmm. I went to a session on District of Innovation, and one of the things I heard was the reticence of many districts in their teachers being fearful that some negative consequences for teachers and students would come of this, as in taking away some of the built-in regulations that the state has for numbers of students in classes, but you've addressed that. Mm-hmm. And things like, and in our session, it talked about the ability of District of Innovation to take away a teacher's conference planning period if a district so decided.
Those are things that we definitely would pursue. That's something that anything, you know, as far as personnel goes, that would not be anything that we would consider.
Right. But you, everything, when the committee comes back with a recommendation, mm-hmm. everything will be spelled out. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. Yes, okay. Most definitely. That, yeah, and if it's not spelled out loud enough or detailed enough for you, we'll get it that way. Because ultimately, you said we have to approve it. And so, but it's everything that will be considered and put on the table to talk about will be for the benefit of the students and for the benefit of the staff and for the benefit of Sabine ISD, so.
I'm gonna trust you on that, Shelley.
I will make sure that happens, okay? So it's a positive thing, and like I said, the board approves everything. If y'all don't like it, we'll go back to the drawing board. That's all there is to it.
Why do we want to start this process? Why do we, I know that we brought it, we voted for it, but since then we've had some opportunities to do a little bit of research. Why do we as Sabine want to start this process?
Well, the first thing is it gives this board more local control than with some of the state regulations. Just like she mentioned before, if this district wants to, right now the laws say just beginning school. You can't begin school until the fourth Monday in August. If we saw benefit to begin earlier than that, then this would give us the okay to do that. Things like, another thing she said was certification areas, which we would look at as hard to fill places such like CTE courses. If you have a master welder that's been welding out there for 30 years, and he or she could teach kids dual credit welding, and for the most part, they're gonna know how to weld far better than a teacher will. And so if they can come in and teach one section of advanced welding, then it allows this board to give him the okay to do that without the teaching certification. You know, things like that.
It's flexibility as much as you can do.
Right, but we can do that currently, can't we?
Not all of this, no.
No, but that what you just said, we can do that currently. We can just have to be certified after a certain amount of time, is that correct?
Oh yeah, but they're not gonna.
They have no
most of are not going to get certified that we're talking about, like a master welder. They don't have any desire to go back to school and get certified as a teacher, you know. And so those scenarios play into it. And we don't have any flexibility whatsoever on the start of school day, you know, right now, none. So.
Which, I mean, if you look at it, it makes total sense. If you start school, I mean, build our calendar to have more structural days prior to state assessing. Mm-hmm.
Doesn't this also allow us to give our teachers more in-classroom planning time than what they have had like in the past year or two?
If the district seeks that instructional minutes,
yes, that'd be in that plan.
The length of school day, if they pursue that exemption, we can plan with more flexibility as far as having half days and letting one half. Teachers have, you know, half a day of professional development or, you know, staff planning on campus. That's the beauty of it. We can create it in how we want to locally as far as that, but we still have to meet those minutes in some form to receive our funding, and that's, I mean, we don't want to lose that by any means. But we can be more flexible in creating that calendar.
I mean, for me, it just falls in line with my core values is that, you know, we should be more in control of our own lives and not state government or federal government. Mm-hmm. So that in itself just lends itself to my vote.
Flexibility and local control.
That's right.
We're not trying to cut
so down. We know what's best for our school district, some legislator in El Paso.
Yeah, just because it works in Dallas ISD or Austin ISD or whatever doesn't necessarily mean it works for Sabine.
Exactly. So those boundaries, you know, as far as timelines, kind of keep us messed up. And if we had just a little more flexibility to kind of step out of those lines and still do what they want us to do, then, you know, that's a win-win for everybody.
I will tell you, too, the same little conference that she went to, I went to one where Mineola was presenting, and they even had two students there, and they've already done this is their first year, and they do like a flex program,
right,
or flex scheduling, and those kids were very, they loved their flex program, their flex schedule, and it had a lot of, it sounded like it had a lot of time for kids to do more independent study at school, which they said allowed for them to do more dual credit, because they could do online, they could get on the computer during their independent learn time and do some online stuff. It also allowed them to do like homework at school, where there might be a teacher there that could help them. They did lots of, but their independent learning time was earned. If you were not, they checked their grades every week. If you were not passing, you did not get independent learning time. You had to go to a structured learning time. Anyway, it was really, they do tours, I think, every Tuesday. You have to make an appointment, but. And then they also talked about like some of the things that they've had this school year that did not work, or that they're gonna have to.
Modify.
And that would be helpful.
That's a beauty, too. Like I said, they can modify that.
Yeah.
And they'll have the opportunity to amend it, make some changes, and there's nothing that.
But they were very pleased, and I did think they had some teachers that were not necessarily on board at the beginning on some of their stuff, but I think some of those teachers have now decided they really like this.
Yeah, and I think with any kind of little change, you know, you're always gonna have that, so.
Fear of change, you know, it's an adjustment. And one thing I will tell you, and I told Mr. Bryce this, that in this session I was in, they said the number one most popular thing that District of Innovation did was change the start date of the school year. But they did caution that they were hearing strong rumblings that because so many districts had done that, the tourism industry was fighting back.
I'm sure they were.
Because that's the reason we have that start date. And that, let's say.
People with 6 miles are getting cranky.
Maybe not, but.
We're here for those kids.
Just for your information, though, that's what I heard.
You either get out.
Yeah.
There's gonna be somebody to travel. Or you start at the end of August and have August to travel. It didn't make sense.
I think the other thing that's great is that it's not just a plan that you vote on, you set on the shelf, and it's done.
Right.
So, you know, we have to wait every 2 years for them to meet and change the rules for us. But here, you know, it allows us that flexibility to make changes as we see fit in a timeline.
It's a little.
That's dependent upon how fast we're able to react, not someone else in Austin.
It is a live document that we're able to modify and edit and do as we need to as we see fit, if and when we want to.
Right. Because whatever we're gonna do in the next 2 years is not gonna be what we do 10 years from now, or 15 years from now, so.
And if we have a plan in place and nothing's working with it, you shut it down. The board can approve and vote to shut it down, and we'll go back to the original. We always.
And there are districts that have done that.
So, and through these committees as well, I forget the acronym, I'm not so good with acronyms, but teachers will be more empowered to help affect change as well.
Sure. Any other questions?
When do we as a district start spending money on?
I'm sorry?
When do we start spending money on?
Well, what do you like, such as?
Well, I mean, I know that there's gonna have to be committees formed, is that correct?
Right.
But that's just our normal district planning committee.
Yeah, that's our normal DEIC anyway. We already have that committee in place.
And that committee was formed for this purpose?
No.
No, it's our normal.
It's our district advisory planning committee.
Right.
And it's that committee that will.
They just then take over, because that's what they would switch to.
That's part of their role.
They're always our planning committee, and then they would just go into a different kind of planning. Now they would be a District of Innovation committee, instead of just what we normally have.
And that's made up of teachers? Solely teachers?
Community members.
Every campus, tell me if I'm wrong, but this is what it's always been. Every campus has a campus improvement committee, and it's made up of teachers and community members and the administrator. Is that not still correct?
Yes.
And then there's a district committee, and it's made up of the same thing, teachers, community members. I don't know how much, how often they normally meet, but I was on that committee every campus I went to, and we met 4 times a year.
I was just looking at the education code, and it was just saying that the board appoints a committee, and I was just making sure that we follow the rules that need to be followed.
Yeah, that's what she was talking about earlier, how the board will approve the committee, you know, she'll bring to you a committee, and for us in our district, the way it would work for this would be the DIC committee. And, you know, the board approves that and they start working on it. But as far as cost, there is no cost to it. You know, there's probably some in here that are on DIC committee and they know they're not going to get paid overtime for coming in. You know, that kind of thing, I don't know. I don't know about any.
Well, I mean, here's my thing is that, you know, even through Michelle's presentation is that we understand that there's a level of responsibility that comes with this flexibility. And, you know, ultimately, I don't know exactly who that falls upon, but I think it's going to fall on us as board members. And I think that we should understand the magnitude of what we're getting into, that this does give the district flexibility to do some different things with teachers' contracts and sizes of classrooms. She mentioned that.
But the teacher, I mean, stuff like as far as the contracts, those are things that the committee, those things that we choose to do, we'll, I mean, if the committee considers those are, it has to be specified in the plan. So there's nothing that we.
Yes, ma'am, I understand that. But when this process begins, that gives us that flexibility, that puts that in play. Is that correct?
If it's listed in the plan, it's not a broad open.
But as a district, if this board wanted to put that in there and this board wanted to vote that in there, that is completely in play at that point is what I'm getting at.
Right.
And I want everybody to understand that.
Yeah.
Yeah, as long as everything still has to meet the state guidelines.
Yes, sir, I understand that. But that gives us the opportunity in those areas that I mentioned that we can do some different things than with the state.
Right.
If there's no other questions, I'm finished.
No other comments, questions, or concerns? All right. Well, if y'all will.
Hey, Stacy, when are we going to do the next step on this?
The next board meeting.
Okay.
Our April 10th, I believe.
We'll call our meeting to order at 6:58. Y'all stand with me. Bow your head. Dear Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity for us to come together for the business of our district. Please guide our thoughts and our words and our actions to the benefit of our district and the glory to you. May all things that we do bring glory to you. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
And the American flag is to your right. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And the Texas to your right, to your honor
the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, to Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you very much. All right, and I want to welcome all of our guests out there. Where y'all go? We just started. What he has to stay? He came in late, you get stuck. I didn't see anybody signed up to speak. Is that still the case? Nobody has signed to speak, correct?
All right, easy enough.
So, some information items you want to cover real quick?
Okay, quickly, there are many, many successes, student successes in the district right now, and I'm not going to go over all of them because there's so many we're going to end up posting them on the website so that everybody can see them because there's a long list. But I do want to hit a couple of highlights with our math science team again. They recently went to San Antonio this past weekend, which is the top meet given every year prior to until we get to state. But the competition is extremely good at this meet, and I will say that our when I say math science team, what they do is, it's a team that consists of taking tests in number sense, calculator, mathematics, and science. And again, our team won sweepstakes at this meet that consists of all 3A schools around the state. Not only did they win, but they set a record because they came out with 3,190 points at that meet. Second place was 2,172. And they went back in the records, and the organization did, went back in the records, and they cannot find a time that anyone had scored 3,190 points. So, again, outstanding job from Keith Taylor, from Laura Hedrick, and the kids, because they put in a lot of time working with this. They're certainly getting ready for state competition. Of course, we had our district UIL athletic meet yesterday, and I'll go into that in just a minute. But we had the top scorer in the state in the 10th grade in 3A. That was Scotty Taylor. We had the top scorer in 11th grade in 3A, that was T. Taylor. And our 12th grade, we had the fifth highest scorer, Carly Sheets, and the second highest scorer, missed by 1 point, Devin Thompson. So these kids have done an outstanding job.
Yeah, Carly was a little girl that just walked out. Yeah. I thought she was going to stick around for a second.
And I wish she would have, but you know, this group, they give a lot of accolades, but I just can't say enough about them. They're doing an outstanding job. We'll hear from the Hallsville person later, but Hallsville was at that meet too, and I believe they came in third in their classification, so good job by them. But again, I can't say enough about these kids and the sponsors on the job that they did at that meet. They took 22 kids to the meet, and gave up 3 days of their spring break. You know, there's not a whole lot of kids that will give up 3 days to go talk about math and science. So,
that's not including the kids that took summertime off to go to math camp.
That's right. So they spent a lot of hours after school time.
It's nice when our kids show up to a meet and the other kids are like, oh crap, Sabine's here.
So we're extremely proud of that group, and as I mentioned, we had our high school UIL academic meet yesterday, day one. Day two will be next Friday, and it's a much smaller portion next Friday. But I'm not going to call out names because we're going to have to post all of them, but this is just out of the different areas. I want to read a few of these. In accounting, we placed individually, we had kids placed first and sixth. Calculator applications, first, second, third, fourth. Current issues, first and second. Computer applications, first, second, and third. Computer science, first, second, third, and fifth. Editorial writing, first and sixth. Feature writing, third, fourth, and fifth. Headline writing, first, third, and fourth. Literary criticism, first and fourth. Mathematics, first, second, third, and fourth. Number sense, first, second, third, and fourth. News writing, second, third, and fourth. Ready writing, first, second, third. Chemistry, first. Science, first, second, third, fourth, and sixth. Spelling vocabulary, first, second, third, and fifth. And in our team events, accounting finished second place, calculator app first place, current issues first place, computer science first place, cross-ex debate first. We entered three teams in that. First, third, and fourth. Journalism first, literary crit first, math first, number sense first, and science first, and spelling and vocabulary first. Those were the teams. So the high school team set an all-time record yesterday of 694 points scored. Second place was 236. A lot of good things 17 events, they won first place in 14 of them. And in the team events, out of 13 events, 10 first place. So great job by all of the sponsors and kids alike.
Will you tell me what schools were involved?
Truth, Arc, Cumberland Academy, Harmony, us, and I'm leaving one out. Why not Harmony? And West Rose, yes, yeah. So all of our teams in our district. So, regional is coming up around April the 8th, I believe. The good thing about regionals, you know, we have 50 kids qualified for regionals. The good thing about that is it's not an overnight trip this year. So
that costs. We can afford it.
But we are taking a bunch of kids. So look forward to seeing that. Look forward to seeing how many we're gonna that are gonna go on their state. So that's exciting.
Yeah, we should have a couple of state championships up there.
Very exciting. So anyway, that's my time to wrap up kids. Okay. So.
Can I add something?
Yes.
Last year we had four or five kids that participated in math and science, and last year was the first year we were really involved with that as a middle school. Coach Taylor and Miss Chalice have been working with those kids and, you know, taking them to meets on Saturday and so forth. And last year, out of the four or five kids, we had one that qualified for state. This year we had 16 that, you know, went to several meets starting in the fall, you know, all of those on Saturday. And we had six of them that qualified to go to state this year. And two of those, well, one of them is a girl that qualified last year. And two of them qualified in two events. But they qualified in calculator, math, and number sense. But we will be taking, you know, those six students to San Antonio next month.
That's great. And yes, two of the eighth grade, last year eighth graders as freshmen this year did extremely well in the competition. So we're excited about that. Anything else?
Count paper.
Anything that you pointed out?
No, there's nothing.
There weren't one income this month. It was over $10,000. It wasn't a normal month.
Just our normal stuff?
Yes.
Okay, as far as the consent items, traditionally we will approve all the consent items as a group unless somebody has something they want to pull from that.
May I make a comment on all the consent items?
Yes, sir.
The tax collections we've been concerned about for several months because they've been running behind the prior year. I got the county tax office to run a report as of yesterday. And for the month of March this year, we collected $697,000 in tax levy for both current and delinquent, compared to $156,000 last year. That difference in collections brought us up to where as of March 22nd this year compared to March 31st last year, we've already collected 91.3% of our current year levy, whereas last year it was 90.38%.
We are a week behind, but at almost a percent ahead.
Correct.
So we're back to where we need to be.
Correct.
Okay.
I wanted to get,
that number looks scary, but if we're back where we need to be, then we're all going to get.
Yeah, but we collected in the first week, we collected that bunch of money.
Okay.
It was quite exciting to print that off.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. When the percentages, when the this year is over last year, that's always a good thing. All right. Well, if nobody has anything else they want to pull out, I have to take a motion to approve the consent items.
Probably the consent items.
Yes, sir. Can I get a motion?
No motion.
Dan, you get a second?
Oh.
Paul? All in favor? Any opposed? Okay, move on to...
Okay, on discussion items, we always give the board a tentative budget calendar to look at. And Kevin, I don't know if there's a whole lot you need to go over on that calendar, but I know all of you had a chance to look at it. And we certainly can discuss, you know, any of those dates. If any of you have prior commitments on those dates, just let us know, because those dates are flexible. But as you see, our process will start March 31st, and then to work through the teachers and staff and then the departments. And then we'll work to the board and we'll start having budget workshops. And that's the down there, the third to the last to be announced, because we'll get y'all's input at that time. And then regular board meetings, June the 12th, where we'll be looking at proposing the budget. And anticipated date for board to adopt the budget is 26th or 27th. And we can look at y'all's calendars when we get closer to that to see what's best for y'all. So, but that's kind of the way we have the budget calendar development set up. So if you have any questions, be sure and let us know, or if you have any right now.
So is there any discussion on 6A? Anybody, anything? What I would like to do, if Ms. Godsey's okay with that, is I can move you up and go ahead and let you do your presentation.
It doesn't matter, I can wait.
You're enjoying the show.
For once.
All right. Let's move on to action item 7A.
Okay, that 7A deals with our student meal prices, and as you know, each year we have to look at that. That's one of those those items that certainly is regulated by the state. We have Sunny here tonight, so she can explain about the whole system, any questions you may have. As you recall, the state put into place, what was it, 3 years ago? The system on something about 3 or 4. Where there's a certain, you had to be in an average of the dollar amount average that you charge for meals. That goes for student meals and adult meals. But anyway, in looking at this, there are some options to look at, and you saw that in your packet, option A, B, and C. The state says that we have to be in a certain range, and normally each year what districts do is try to make the smallest increase as possible so it doesn't affect the families, you know, as much. But Sunny, do you want to cover anything on your process that you go through or look at to get this information?
The numbers are entered into the calculator. They're all based on meals served in October. That's how I get our average cost of the meals, and that number is the one I plug in. What it boils down to is if our average is less than 284, which it's been that same number since we first started this, then we have to do an increase. Our only option is either we increase our student prices, or the district agrees to make up the difference using non-federal dollars. There's a 10-cent cap that they have on all. That's all we're required to do is a 10-cent raise in prices. And it would be the choice of the board if anything higher than that was applied.
And currently the high school meal price is $2.70, middle school $2.45, elementary $2.20. And so the options for the board is, option A is increasing prices 10 cents on each campus. Option B would be increase high school 25 cents for meals, and then middle school and elementary 5 cents. Or option C, increase high school 5 cents, middle school 15, and elementary 10. Normally, the way, of course, we've done it in the past is do the 10 cent for each campus across the board to just make it even. And I don't know of any, you know, Sunny has it all spelled out for us right here as far as the options are concerned. So is there any discussion on, I know something I talked about, of course, our preference would be option A, but certainly, you know, if there's any other discussion on option B or C, we're...
Does that just have to do with portion sizes?
No.
They give the same portion to the little kids as they do the big kids.
Oh, okay.
That's not true.
Actually, high school students get 3/4 cup servings of all vegetables. This school year, all of their meat portions have been raised to 3 ounces instead of 2. So we have made efforts to increase those portion sizes. They get 2 grain rolls, whereas middle school elementary get 1.
I was talking about my 14-year-old freshman who's 5 foot nothing, weighs 75 pounds, and a 250-pound football player. They go through the line together.
Yeah, I bid on that.
Right. Sonny, how's this money going to help? How does more help in this situation?
Have more money?
Yeah.
It's state.
Where else is it going to help you?
State requirements.
Well, I understand that. But we have these other options. How is this money, how will more money help you in this situation? Would it?
Are you talking about which option is better?
Yeah.
Oh.
Those three options basically come out to be at the same money budget to a number of kids on those campuses.
Because we feed fewer kids on the high school campus, that's why it would have to be a bigger raise on the high school campus. All of the numbers you see, option A, B, and C, get us to the same average cost. But because we serve fewer students on high school than, say, elementary, you have to go up a lot more on the high school campus to do a smaller increase on the other two. But it's all just to try to get us to that 10 cent cap of our average price. There's just different ways to get there.
You don't have to watch Dr. Morchette on the
radio. Yes, sir.
I don't have a comment. I actually would, I'm ready to make
a motion.
Make a motion to accept option A.
Okay, need a second?
I'll do it.
Paul, any other discussion? All in favor? Any opposed? We're all good. There, good to be.
All right, and each year, you know, we accept transfer students in our district. And it's spelled out in policy, the regulations on that. And this board in the past has approved the criteria for granting the local criteria for granting transfers that's not in board policy. So we look at this. We made adjustments to it year before last, and there are things, when things come up, we want to look at to see if there's any other additions or deletions we need on that. And looking at this, there's been a couple of items that we think would help on the situation, just like number 3, one of the criteria is resident students who become non-residents during the course of a semester shall be permitted to continue the attendance on a tuition basis for the remainder of the school year. And you know, we've always done that. The part that we think we probably need to include in there is if the transfer application is approved, which, you know, that's one of those situations to where you go back to policy then and you look at why may not be approved, you know, attendance, discipline, those type of things. So that would help clarify things for parents, because that was not clear for parents. Also, number eight on there, one thing that we would like to add, which has always been the practice, is, and that's in any district, but we wanted to make it clear for the parents of transfer students that parents of transfer students are responsible for their own, for their child's transportation to school. We cannot go across school district boundaries and pick kids up and that type of thing. So, and I know that's always been understood, but we wanted it spelled out for the parents when they look at this. And the reason I'm coming to the board with those small additions is because the board has taken action on this prior, so I want to keep it that way.
So your recommendation would be?
My recommendation would be to approve the local criteria with those two changes as presented.
So your motion?
I'll make a motion.
Get a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor of the modifications? Opposed?
I don't feel like I know quite enough to, I'm just going to have to say.
Yeah, that's fine. Next one. Okay.
Okay, next item is instructional materials allotment, and Kevin has this one. If you go ahead, Kevin.
Okay, thank you. This is a form that we have to complete to get the board to approve each year. It's the initial part of the process of us acquiring books through the EMAT system of the Texas Education Agency. And it's the instructional materials allotment and peak certification. And it basically just says that our district is going to have the instructional materials necessary to cover all the elements of the peaks. And then it lists, we check off on the form the grade levels that we're certifying, which is kindergarten through 12. And then all the different options, the subject area options that they have. We also have the materials certified to cover the peaks in those areas as well. This is a process we go through each year. If we don't turn this form in, then we're not allowed to buy any books at all to read them. So I would highly recommend that the board approve
this form. Okay. So based on Kevin's recommendation, can I get a motion? Paul, second. Awesome. Go ahead. Any discussion? All in favor? Unanimous and opposed? All right, next.
Okay, the next is another routine item. You saw in your packet, I put in there the information from Region 7. But basically, this is the board needs to certify the superintendent to the Regional Advisory Committee of Region 7 in order to execute all the documents related to the service center. And it's a requirement that Region 7 has this information on file. So every district in the region, goes through this every year. Or if it's a charter school, the CEO of the charter school is named to that advisory committee. That's to go through the contracts that the districts contract out with, or through Region 7, things of that nature. So it's one of those things after, if it's going to be approved, we need to fill that form out and sign it so we can get it sent into Region 7. So, okay. Recommendation would be to approve appointing me to the Regional Advisory Committee.
Okay. Good motion.
I so motion.
Okay. And a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussions? All in favor? Opposed?
Okay, Kevin, go ahead with that.
Okay. The next item on the agenda is to do with two purchase orders that together, one by itself exceeds $50,000, but there are two of them that are the same vendor for technology-related equipment for the elementary campus. And part of the board policy, we're required to bring these to the board to get approval to purchase these items. They're both being funded through Title I funding. And at this point right now, we're waiting on the state's approval of the latest amendment in our grant application before we actually initiate the purchase of these items. But before we can even do that, we have to get the board's approval because they exceed $50,000. It's basically Chromebook carts and 25 Chromebooks in each of the five carts, and then 11 individual Chromebooks that are being bought for staff members so that they can work with them, learn how to use them, so they can teach the kids how to use them. And then my recommendation is the board approve these purchases.
Okay. Based on his recommendation, we'll get a motion.
I'll make a motion.
Paul talking?
Okay.
We get a second? Any discussion?
I do have one question,
yes,
Mr. President, and I think I know the answer to it, but I just want to point it out. It says, due to the changes in funding of elementary personnel, it's freeing up some money. Now, that's not because we cut funding to personnel. That was simply we reclassified them.
That's correct. Okay. We moved two of the ladies from being funded with federal line money.
Yeah, okay.
Being funded.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to make sure we're not cutting any
stuff. That's right.
We're trying to throw them up for people.
Yeah. That day's coming.
Did he say that?
No, I meant like robots and stuff.
Yeah. All right, any other discussion? All in favor? None opposed?
Okay, next. Okay, our next one is looking at approving a new school depository, and this is something that Kevin put out RFQs and you've got good responses, and you can look at the matrix, and I know y'all did look at the matrix and see how these different institutions scored. But I'll let Kevin discuss that since he's the one that dealt with these banks as they brought their information in. So, Kevin.
Thank you, sir. We as a school district are required to go out for proposals for a school depository every 2 years, where we have the option to extend the contract with the bank for two-year terms if we want to. Well, we would have been at the end of the 6 years this coming June, so we would have had to go through this process in about 2 months anyway. But because of the problems we've been having with the branches closing down with Capital One, we're moving that process up a few months. I went through the banks in our area that had branches in either Kilgore, Bladewater, and or Longview, and contacted seven different financial institutions to see if they were interested in receiving a proposal package. Once the board approved it, I sent the proposal packages out to those seven institutions. They either were mailed to them or they came by and picked them up personally. We received back five responses to the request. Regions Bank did not respond one way or the other. I never got a response that they were going to send it back or anything. After I got no response from First National Bank East Springs, which is the one down here at the four-way stop sign, I contacted the branch manager, and he told me that the explanation he got from the higher-ups in Hughes Springs was that as a financial institution, they were already loaded with the most governmental entities that they could handle with having to buy securities to then pledge as collateral for the money that governmental entities would put into the bank. And as a result, they were not going to be able to present a proposal to us to see if we could bank down there. So that's the reason that I don't have them listed on here, is because they were not able, because of that decision, they were not able to even present a proposal. I went through each of the proposals extensively. It's not something that you want to do in the middle of the night, because it will put you to sleep, unless that's what you want to do. I'm not going to go through all three detailed sheets, just to tell you, if you look at the recap of the evaluation scoring, you can see that out of a total 100 possible points, Texas Bank and Trust scored 95, which is the highest of all of them. Before we even initiated the proposal process, several of the Texas Bank and Trust staff came out and made a presentation to myself and to people in the business office. So we felt like they were very interested. They've got a branch in Bladewater, they've got a branch obviously in Longview. They also have a branch in Lindale and a branch at Hideaway Lake, close to where Bill lives. So that provides a lot of convenience, plus a lot of more assurance of stability that they're going to have branches open to us. So based on the evaluations that I did, it's my recommendation that we enter into a contract with Texas Bank and Trust that would take us from whenever it's approved by TEA through June 30th, and then in the month of May or June, I would then present to you another proposal to extend that contract for another 2 years.
So based on its recommendation, the motion?
I'll make a motion.
Paul, get a second. Any conversation or discussion? All in favor? All right. Come here real quick. How did you see this?
Yes.
It's not me. It's not. And it's not just her. Yeah. It's not just her. As we're flipping down, we're getting a lot of light. I guess it's 112. I think it's because it's 112-page document, and there's a lot of things on here that's doing it. But we're missing entire sections. Just FYI.
I thought it was just fine.
I want to give you aware of this thing. Not a big deal, but if you don't know, you can't fix it. Alright, so that gives us to the foundation.
Okay. As you know, we've talked about developing the Education Foundation here in our district for quite a while.
Are we going to?
Yeah, I'm afraid not.
I don't. You, the people that are down in front of me are about to get blinded.
Yeah, and there's going to be some things on the screen you may want to see. So feel free to rearrange the chairs.
They're going to look at the chairs up there.
Okay, again, we've looked at developing an education foundation here in our district for quite a while, and I had given you information regarding the Education Foundation development earlier, and I've continued to put that in your packet again tonight. So, but anyway, we talked about getting someone here from Foundation Development Consultants to discuss this, and I've worked with Dr. B out of Colorado before in developing this at Henderson ISD. Beth Dodsey is at Hallsville. This is who is with us tonight. She, what's your title as far as the foundation?
I'm the executive director of foundation.
Executive director of their foundation. And they also used foundation development consultants, and she does work for them now also. So it saved us a ton of money to get Beth to drive over here from Hallsville instead of getting Dr. Pink to fly here from Colorado. So we appreciate you being here, Beth. And she is going to give us an overview of how the process works and tell us a little bit more about the foundation development. So,
okay, I'm going to start with myself. I've been part of the Hallsville Education Foundation since it started in 2001. I became a full-time executive director of the school, which I paid my salary in 2009. The Hallsville Education Foundation, we're currently celebrating our 15th year of making a difference in the lives of the students of Hallsville, students and teachers. Our Greatest of Teachers program has allowed us to explore their own creativity and innovation. And we want to make sure we aren't resting on yesterday's successes, but tomorrow's opportunities. We've raised $1 million, and this is something that can happen right here at Sabina High School too. And if you're affected by it, more like Hallsville is, or you have current cuts in state funding every year, they cut more and more. If you approve the formation of the Education Foundation, you know, it makes sense to do that. It's a true difference maker, capable of preserving the quality of the education in your schools. It sounds like you're doing a great job with all those district kiddos there in the math and science team, so this will just kind of continue those successes. Okay, we're going to take a look at the PowerPoint. Philanthropy in the United States is a $150 billion industry. Over $15 trillion are in the hands of America's mature population. And intergenerational transfer of wealth ranging from $15 to $40 trillion will change hands in the USA in the next 25 to 35 years. Over $50 billion was donated to education in 2014, and that's second just behind religion. School districts must position themselves to remain competitive in accessing alternative sources of funding, and the most effective funding vehicle for that would be establishing a foundation. The benefits of having a foundation are provides a 501c3 tax incentive for people who make donations that can write it off for taxes, promotes positive image of the district, enhances educational opportunities for the students, encourages exemplary classroom instruction, I can never say that word, sorry, and expands positive school community relationships. The FDC process, these are just the initial phases that we would cover with you: legal documentation, development model, identifying or recruit directors, conduct the organizational meeting, Dr. Cable file for the IRS, filing for the 501c3, approve organizational model and initial funding priorities, raise money, and solicit and award grants. Successful foundation traits include but are not limited to these right here: active visibility by the superintendent and the representative of the Board of Trustees, clearly stated goals and objectives, the director's ownership of the foundation, strong support by the staff of the school, district's priorities and broad-based initial funding categories are established, and short-term and long-term fund attraction plans in place. The basic development components that we'll cover our initial planning, again, the legal consideration, organizational model, mission statement, goals, your funding priorities, marketing materials, public relations, really everything that you need to get going for the first year and all the way through the whole second, you know, in the future year. They call the first year the founder's drive. Every year after that is called the annual drive. So that always confused me for the longest time, but I didn't understand that terminology, but it works now. After you get to your second year, you get it. There are four essential considerations when you're selecting your board members for your foundation board. Expertise, you'd like to have someone that's a banker or, you know, some kind of, everybody, there's all kinds of characteristics on your board. There's worker bees, there's some rule followers, all those kind of people. But having the expertise, such as a banker, is a good example. Financial resources, do they have a Rolodex that they can bring to the table? Or can they write the check that some people have said that you want on to be on one of your board of directors? Commitment of time and talents, and influence in the community. here's some specific background considerations when you're selecting board members. CEOs of local major businesses and corporations, trust officers, CPAs, and financial planners, that could be somebody that you might want to be your treasurer, someone that handles money. Professionals in the media industry, actively involved former employees and school board members. It's always good to get some retired teachers on there. Attorneys involved in estate planning, worker type individuals, because it's just like any other group, whether it's Little League baseball or whatever, you can have that 80-20 thing where, you know, 20% of people are doing work. Cross-section of ethnic representation and representation from the district's geographical areas. Some of the responsibilities foundation directors have, they serve as ambassadors of goodwill from your foundation and district, and it's really good if you have something positive and you're trying to get it out there to the public. We have 30 board members, and if those 30 people know, then they're telling 30 people, you know, things like that. So it's a good way to get some positive stuff out there, especially when there's negative stuff going on. Accept positions of responsibility, that'd be your committees or officers you have. There's different, a lot of different areas that can get on different committees and stuff. Cultivate and solicit prospects. We'd like to know every board member has needs to give us, like I said, a Rolodex of people that you could solicit. Assist in enlistment of volunteers that's needed to carry out the work at the foundation. Assist in evaluating applications submitted to the board for recommending grant awards. And that's my grant review committee that we have there. Today we actually read grants this morning, and I'm excited. We're going to award like $65,000 in grants this April. So I'm kind of excited about that. Attend meetings necessary for the effective functioning of the foundation. Our board members are required to come to at least, if they miss three in a row, we can move them to associate directors, or we can vote to get them off the board. Provide leadership to ensure the foundation's present and future successes. On that note about attending meetings, we realize that sometimes there's, you know, seasons in people's lives where they have to take care of a sick parent or a child, something like that. So we'll just move them to associate directors at that time. The next steps include your action plan. Identify professional consulting experience and expertise. Review and approval of the proposal that you have. Appoint a staff steering committee and begin developing the foundation. Dr. Pete and the Foundation Development Consultants is ready to move forward with you. Should it be your decision, we would love to work with you. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about the Possible Education Foundation. Like I said a while ago, we raised $4 million. We currently have an endowment of $260,000 right now. And we have just awarded, what we did today just pushed us way over $400,000 that we've awarded in teaching grants. In addition, we have nearly, we've awarded $50,000 in dual credit course scholarships to some students since the fall of 2010 semester. We've also partnered, when we have small fundraisers, we partner with different campuses and organizations and school organizations. Like, we had an Ugly Sweater run in December, and we partnered with the high school cross country team that came and helped us, and we just split the profits with them. We had a fishing tournament in February at Kirkie, and we split the profits with our high school fishing team. We have a test drive event, usually with Ford, the kids are Ford, and depends on what campus we might have it on. We kind of move it around, spread the love, and then we split some money with the campuses that we held up. And so that's how more money that we give out. We give money to our teachers of the year. We provide new teacher grants at the beginning of August. I get to meet with the new teachers coming to the district, and we give away $500 mini grants to new teachers that come in. And much more that's not included in those numbers I gave earlier. Again, this is the same thing that can happen right here in SVNISD. Okay, let's take a look at your proposal that you have in your book there, and I'll answer a few questions you may have after kind of go over this. Now I'm going to actually show a video. Do you want to watch the video real quick so everybody can sit down and just
yeah, have
a okay. Go ahead and just watch the video real quick now. This is just the Hospital Education Foundation in action. I just want to give you kind of a look at what foundations do.
Okay.
Well, while he's trying to do that, let's go ahead and go and look at the proposal one more minute. The primary function of the foundation development consultants is assisting schools in establishing a foundation or redirecting foundations, existing foundations. Dr. Pate uses models, his models are from research and from the 150 school districts that he's helped kind of feedback to him and telling things we need to tweak or whatever. While Sabina and Sima will have a primary consultant who is a principal contact at FDC, a team thinking approach is what we're looking for. Dr. Pate works with me and several other practitioners, and like I said, he worked with over 150 school districts, and 100 of those were here in the state of Texas. Okay, I'm just going to continue, okay?
Sorry.
It is evident that you already previously determined that the education foundation concept was a favorable option for Sabina ISD, otherwise we would be here tonight. But once you approve the task of the steering committee and the subsequent foundation board of directors is to develop the foundation efficiently and in a manner that assures ongoing success. Input from the board of trustees and the community and the administration and consideration of a variety of specific additions are used to develop the optimal foundation organizations and structure. It's our responsibility to help each client find the appropriate organizational structure, develop a comprehensive fundraising program, and implement the foundation to the best advantage of Sabina ISD. There is an ongoing relationship even after you get through. It just doesn't stop after these consultations. Matter of fact, we've been going for 15 years, like I said, and anytime throughout this 15 years, I've called Dr. Pate and he advises me on different things, and you know, that's a good customer service right there. Our primary goal is to see that Sabina ISD students do not suffer from the lower expectations or the loss of opportunity as the district faces cuts in funding. Dr. Pate, doctor, that's throwing me off, y'all. Truly great meeting you.
That's good, I promise.
Dr. Pate will be at the organizational meeting at the board of directors, which is the third consultation. Depending on when you approve the formation of the foundation, he could be here for the third. It could be the end of May, as early as end of May. It takes 3 to 5 minutes after he does, 3 to 5 months after he does IRS paperwork for you to get your determination letter. And so you can wait and elect to do that in August. But our model kind of started, we started about the same time that y'all are right now, in April. We had our steering committee in April and May, kind of waited till August, brought on our board of directors for our whole board. And then had kickoff November, had staff appeal. By January 31st, we had $100,000 in the bank. We were able to award grants that take applications from teachers and award grants and have proper control at April. So that's how quick this kind of moves. It's not like live on or anything. We actually shattered Weatherford ISD Foundation, and we went to them and spent a few days with them. Different times we took trips over there. And I'm going to do the same thing here with y'all, share anything that we have. Most of the foundations all use the same policies and procedures and stuff, and then we just kind of steal the idea instead of having to recreate the wheel, because it's already a proven model. Once the foundation board is in place, the steering committee will cease to function in the foundation's executive committee. That board that y'all make up, that steering committee makes up, will assume leadership, assuming leadership role, and like I said, that could be in August or so. There's still some more consultations, 6, 7, 8, so it covers organizing the Sabine ISD Alumni Association. You already have one?
No.
Other fundraising events and strategic planning, usually in the summer we do strategic planning and kind of just get you on, you set your goals and determine all your programs that you're going to fund and things like that during strategic planning. On page of your proposal, it talks about the projected income and return on investment. And Dr. G projects that you're going to raise $100,000 the first year. It seems if you follow this method, you're kind of skeptical at the beginning because we are too, because y'all like we are, we don't have any industry in Hallsville at all. We have five foundations, very fine foundations all around us, Lynn Marshall, three in Columbia, everybody pulling into the same industry, trying to suck the blood out of them. And but based on that, you will get there. Fortunately, Dr. P has established a long-term relationship with the founder of the Texas Pioneer Foundation. They're friends. And Dr. P is willing to write a grant for y'all to get the consulting fees reimbursed so you're not to offset the cost of it. So you're not adding money other than the $25 for the Secretary of State fee and $850 for the IRS determination.
Just to not blaze through what you just said, there is a $15,000 consulting fee. There is a grant for $15,000 that nearly every school gets approved for to offset those consulting fees so that we're not out that money.
Exactly. You just can't get it right away.
Right, you have to do the work to apply for the grant to get paid back. You can't get the grant until you have a foundation.
Exactly.
And you can't get a foundation until you spend $15,000. So just be aware of that.
Not even all the $15,000, you wouldn't spend that much, but it was.
Yeah, just the expectation we get reimbursed that $15,000.
The one thing that I had wondered since day one when we first started talking about this was, has he not ever written any other grants for foundations? Been hired to write other grants for other funding?
Actually, your foundation will do that yourself. You'll have a grant writing committee, and there's tons of money out there that books, this deck, and there's also online resources. We do that, we write for other corporations, there's tons of money. I know all that money was on the first line.
Right.
And so you do that after you start, you do that. But Dr. Pitt just gets that $15,500 right back for you as soon as he can.
Okay. So y'all would assist with that, or are the committee that we form would be charged?
No, that's part of the in the consulting thing. You'll cover some of that in the different consultations.
Well, I guess a little bit I've been around grant writing. It's very
tedious. As soon as you have
complicated.
As soon as you have information, that's the things that you get. A lot of it's online nowadays, and so when you're up at
like, okay, so that process is simplified.
Yeah, once you have all your information and somebody writes you a cheat sheet, then you can work on that at home.
Okay, so with the committee members would actually be charged with that process of filing.
The expectation is you do have a grant writing committee of people that are the board members of the foundation that are responsible for that role.
So that's where some worker bees.
That's why you need
those committees. And then some people probably can't go out and solicit. There's a lot of people that can't make the ask. I always have them, always just say, well, all they can do is say no, right? Yeah. So I'm not asking anybody for it. I'm not asking anybody for it. Y'all haven't had it. But anyway, so a lot of people can't make the ask in person, so they don't mind, you know, they don't mind asking online, you know, to somebody they don't even know.
Okay.
Sorry, making the ask to your friend.
I kind of put it like doing scholarships. I mean, when Tyler was doing scholarships, we filled every scholarship we could find.
Right.
And just they were some more complicated than others, but figure it out. And that's kind of what we're
grant writing can be.
Oh, I know.
Yeah. Want to use. So.
Yeah. And there are workshops that you can go to. There's actually a free workshop in April. The deadline to register for that is March the 27th. If any of y'all are interested in going, you can register with the Texas Pioneer Foundation, actually, does it. And it's in San Marcos. And you learn a whole lot when you go to the conference. It's free. Like I said, they actually give away tons of money that day, too, but during that 2 days they have it.
So, Kevin, would you mind staying 2 or 3 hours extra today? Because I know you've written something. I'm trying to be on the committee right now by a member, and he's already trying.
But she mentioned,
y'all can go ahead and have a seat.
Is the steering committee different from the foundation members?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
The steering committee, I'll see you back in here in a minute. I'm going to go along there right now. The steering committee is basically, Mr. Rice, one of the school board members, usually not be the director of curriculum or some other administrator in the school district. He digs the principals. And somebody that might, that you might select to be your possible president of the foundation. And then what they do is there's just proposed, they just propose everything and try to get everything going. So when you do, get your board lined out, y'all will make the board, each one of y'all pick, everybody on the steering committee will suggest people then in the community that you'd like to have on the board. And it'd be like retired teachers, all those people that I explained that they're business owners, local business owners, all board members, things like that.
So it's the steering committee that gathers the foundation members?
Yeah, we, as a steering committee, that we develop a steering committee. Steering committee develops a board for the foundation.
Okay.
This board basically steps away and they run as their own entity.
There's a whole separate corporation, a whole separate corporation with the school. Now there is, when the board gets established, the foundation board of directors, there is a superintendent on there and a school board member. Ours usually rotates. They're on it for a year or two, and then they kind of have, usually the new person that comes on, they get the big one to get on. That's how that happens. But no more than two school people are on our board because we don't actually want them telling us what to do with the money, but they're there for, you know, just a liaison in between the school district and the foundation. They really know what's going on in school, what their needs are, and things like that. But steering committee, you'll each give, they're called respected directors. And so each gets on a list, like 3 to 4 people that you think might be good. Y'all get together, we'll send them like an invitation letter to see if they're interested. Then you have, kind of have a meeting where they kind of learn a little bit about the foundation before they say, yeah, I'll do that or whatever. And then,
you know, I'm curious of your number of 30. Is that normal, expected, unique?
Every board's a little different. We fluctuate between 25 to 35, but we like to stay around 30. The more you get, of course, the more quorum you have.
Well, you know, everybody has their own little Rolodex, so you have more Rolodexes.
Yeah, you have more Rolodexes. And we've always been around that many. We never have dropped down. There are some foundations, when I've come to conference, they have like 8 people on like early. I don't know how you do that, because there's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah.
Well, you choose for more skills too, right. Skill sets from people when you have 30.
Yeah, it's easy to get a grant writing committee when you have 30 people to choose from.
Yeah, exactly. And there's several committees, and they're usually, everybody tries to sign up and do everything, you know, because they really don't know what they want to do, but they'll wear themselves out doing that. Check two or three things that you want to do that you have a skill set for. There's a grant writing committee, there's a finance committee. There's a public relations committee. Our public relations person at the school doesn't do anything for, you know, for us or whatever. Some schools, their public relations person is the foundation executive director.
Go roll.
So when our foundation first started up, it was a director of curriculum for 8 years. So she was, you know, probably all girls. She was over nurses, student teaching, counselors, librarians, and all that. And it was just me and her in there doing all that plus foundation. And of course, when she retired, we had hired 7 people.
It took 3 people to replace her.
So anyway, the steering committee starts, which you were asking a while ago, the steering committee, they propose everything and get kind of get it started. And then once we get that determination thing, the formation of the corporation, then kind of state operation, and then the board of directors takes over. And that's where they do all the fundraising and everything. You really don't do any fundraising or anything. You're just kind of building the board.
Got a question about the fundraisers. More curiosity, because I'm sure it's going to come up eventually. It's being smaller than Hallsville, obviously. Oh, yeah. And it's the same people get hit up for every ag, every football, baseball, band. It doesn't matter what it is, the same 15 or 20 people are going to get asked. How do y'all handle when it's foundation? Because we had our project graduation called the 4 people into a fundraiser. Well, if the foundation pulls that, well, then that's not a project graduation fundraiser anymore. How do you deal with, it's a foundation fundraiser, not the band, not the ag, not the...
I kind of stay away from trying to hit up whoever the softball or the baseball, and all them are hitting up, and the football. I don't like to seek out their graduate program up and, you know, football time, go through all this.
Yeah, find all the advertising.
Yeah, we don't do that, and I hope that they don't do the same thing with us. You kind of just find, like, your founder's drive, that very first drive. Those people have stuck along with us the whole time, and that's what carries us without having to do a bunch of fundraisers. You gotta have some fundraisers too, but that first set of founders, of course, I've been dying off now. I'm assuming 15 years, and a lot of those people, I'm serious. A lot of those people, the husband's died, or the wife's died now, you know, and so we're kind of getting lower and lower and lower on our original money without having to make a pass. Those are people that'll just write a check without wanting something for it. It's sad that these days people want something for the money. They want to know what's in it for me. So we found that out. We have an event every October. It's called Get Right, Get Loud. It's out at Carter Ranch. Some people like it, some people don't. It's your thing, you know. But we raised $75,000 after that report came out. We actually raised $75,000 Get Right, Get Loud this last year. Last year we raised $50,000. And so that's our biggest fundraiser that we do.
Well, we played in the golf tournament. Y'all had a foundation
golf tournament. This year we got a 15th annual golf tournament. That one just varies. We made $4,000 or $5,000 off of 4 hours of playing golf. And that's good money. You do the hourly rate on that. We recently threw in the staff appeal is good too. Our staff gave about $10,295 this year through payroll deductions. Good thing with that is you get incentives. Like I said, people want something. They have a chance to win a gift card at local restaurant or whatever else. We also had a bunco night recently in February in a fishing tournament, and we did that ugly sweater run. Like I said, something for everyone. We have something. It was $20 a year or whatever. Then we'll have our golf tournament, and then it just starts all over again. That's our current fundraisers. We didn't start with all that. We started with first the golf tournament. And then it just kind of, every year, those teachers are asking for more and more stuff. Maybe more stuff
in the classroom. Fulfill the grant request, you've got to find more ways to bring in more money.
Exactly. It's so frustrating not to have enough money to fill everything that they're asking for. And you have to turn some people down, and that's not like that. So I have to say, every grant that got turned in this year, we funded everyone. So then I was kind of upset that more people didn't turn in grants. But anyway, it's one of them. That was just today. So, like I was telling you a while ago, Dr. Pete has that relationship with the Texas Pioneer Foundation. So, actually, it's not really, it's basically investment and not expenditure. I'm going to get that way. That's really all I got. It's on my video over there.
No, we really do appreciate you coming. I mean, I realize that you're not an employee of film, but you're still very knowledgeable and can be a resource for us a little bit, just being as close as you are. It really does.
When you, even, you know, it says in there travel and stuff for a consultant, and I would probably be your consultant to come over here just because I live so close, and I just don't like that because I just believe in paying it forward.
We appreciate it. We really do. It helped us out significantly to have you here tonight because where is he at?
He's in Colorado.
Colorado, yeah. I knew it wasn't even in Texas, so what do you
mean? He's not strong now.
Does anybody else have?
Yeah, I will say this, he does watch out after, he makes sure that he doesn't suggest things that will spend school district money. You know, he just like tonight. He said, I'll be glad to come.
I mean, 15 years ago, I think his salary, I mean, his consulting thing was $12,000. So it's not like he's just, you know, up in it because, oh, this is a thing, I need to change this process. It was $12,000 15 years ago. And we didn't have opportunity to write a grant. My superintendent at that time, we had Dr. Pepper machines all over campus and stuff, and took the Dr. Pepper money in that towel. We started up our foundation.
You funded your foundation with Dr. Pepper? Yeah, Dr.
Pepper
sure, maybe I was good with that.
All the
quarters
you got in here,
that's
how we did it.
Dr. Morchad had a question.
Yeah, actually, I've got several questions and several comments, if you will allow me. I'd like to start by commending the board, the prior board, and the whole idea of a foundation. You know, since this was on the agenda, I went and Googled, and I would recommend that you all Google school foundations. And the more you dig and read, that is a very innovative way of supporting innovative programs. And I use that word specifically because I think there's actually some opportunities there for innovative procedures that are now have a source of funding. The fact that we're probably going to get reimbursed most of the fee is kind of gravy. Even if we didn't, I think it's well worth the investment, considering the possible return. I do, however, have just a few questions. You mentioned about the board, and that's going to be, again, one of the problems is finding enough community people willing to do the time.
Yes.
About how many board meetings, on average, does the foundation board, once it's established, have a year?
We generally meet once a month, but okay. We don't meet, sometimes we don't meet in December. It depends on when the November meeting falls. We don't meet during the summers. May, we don't meet because we actually had an top 10% academic reception and donors reception that day, where we, our top 10% students pick an educator that made a difference in the lives, so that's our meeting up for that month. So there's probably maybe 8 meetings at the least, you know, at the minimum. And then, of course, if you're on a committee, like if you're on the big fundraiser, that Get Round and Get Loud, that committee meets a lot, you know, coming up to it, you know, like monthly, then 3 weeks, and 2 weeks before, and things like that.
The contract also refers to a primary consultant. Did I hear you say that you'll probably be our primary consultant?
Yeah, I hope I can help you out and do that. Yeah.
Okay, because that ties into another question, and the contract also refers to reimbursement of travel. And if we were going to have to pay Dr. Peake to come from Colorado every time, that could add up to quite a bit of dollars too.
So
he'll come a few times.
He'll come once.
Oh,
now,
okay.
He'd like to come once to the organizational meeting, and that's
Coach.
When your actual board of directors, that all you know, whoever's on the steering committee puts together, that's the meeting that he would come to. That they'll like select terms of office, they'll do different things like that at that meeting.
And one last question, and since this is a 501c3, and that's one of the beauties of it, because now donors can get a deduction. And again, you do your donations often because of your heart. But it doesn't hurt to be able to write it off your taxes either.
Exactly.
And this will make it that much easier. But because it's a 501c3, and hopefully if Sabine gets to the numbers of 100,000 or more a year, I'm assuming and assure me that there are very stringent financial regulations in terms of audits and bonding and stuff like that that goes along with maintaining money. Because the school district, I'm assuming, you have to keep separate.
You separate. Separate. You want to keep it separate. Right. We have our own tax filing number. The treasurer of our board is a financial planner in Longview. We don't have our money invested with his company at all because that's just a conflict of interest with him and his company he works for. Our bank is still at the same bank with the school bank's at. We do audits. We're not audited by at the same time that the school is or anything like that. We don't do that. Basically, we have our system that we do. I'm sure everybody has their own system. There was another question we had.
Well, just kind of the bonding of the treasury.
We do have insurance. We go through Kansas Smith. That's who our school district uses for insurance. And every year they just send me a bill for the next year. But all the officers are bonded and insured. Okay. You know.
So, yeah, one of the other things I know, and depending on where your money's invested or how it's put set aside, you're bound on how much money you can keep in your bank account too. So you have to expend more dollars.
You're real optimistic.
Well, that is the nature of it. I mean, you have to be careful when you're funding.
Like today, we had $103,000 in our checking account today. So based on that, our fund management policy, and that's what's something that you'll propose, the steering committee will put together. We give 40 to 60% in grants. We give 20 to 40% in endowment. We're trying to build an endowment so that we don't have to keep fundraising. And then 0 to 20% is our operating expenses. Right now, our operating expenses are around 8%. I try to keep it down as low as I can. I don't just buy whatever I can buy. The school does give me a little bit of a budget, but it's just, you know, for my paper and coffee and things like that. I don't, really get a hold, it's probably $1,300 or something like that, it's not enough. Matter of fact, I told them they could keep it this next year, but I just gave them a job. But anyway, it's just, I just think that because more budget cuts and stuff that y'all are going to have here, it just makes sense, you know, to, for the teachers to get what they need.
Is there any, no action we have to take on this, is there? We have to take action to do what?
The next one.
Yeah, the last action item.
The form of foundation and then the very simple.
Yeah, okay. So I guess my question, any more, is there any other discussion or questions for Beth at this time? If not, my recommendation would be that the board approve the resolution to move forward on creation of the Education Foundation and to approve the agreement for consulting services with foundation development consultants.
Can we get a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Oh, Dr. Morchat, second. Any discussion? Oh, yes, sir.
Well, could we divide that into two resolutions, one for the resolution and then the second one for the agreement?
We can.
Okay.
We can.
So for the first, for the resolution, Hall, the second, Dr. Morchat, any discussion? All in favor? Okay. The second recommendation motion will be
approve the agreement that's in the packet for consulting services with foundation development consultants, which
okay.
is
so the recommendation to go forward with the contract. The motion. Dan, second. Dr. Morchat, any discussion? All in favor? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
We'll get it to where else can see that video.
See you again.
Is that on the found? Is it on your website?
It's not actually on the website. I need to tell copy of it.
Okay. If you can leave that copy, I'll make sure they get copies. Or if you can send me another copy.
Is it on? Is it on your laptop or is it on the flash?
It's on a disk.
It's on a disk. You can keep that. I'm just going to send my flash out. And we'll just set up a time
and
for a strict meeting.
Just give it to me.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
All right. So with that, we're going to close session at 8:14.
Yes.